I'm Peter Brown from Tiny and Sons Glass. Tiny and Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny and Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
The meeting of Pembroke Conservation Commission is now called to order. The time is 7:30 p.m. And the state has named a number of staff present.
State the names.
Rick Madden.
Art Egerton.
Scott Clark.
Bobby Clark.
And Rachel Fowler.
Secretary. If the meeting is being recorded, the following must be recorded at the start of each meeting. Please note that the meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and an audio broadcast on the Claim Cost Government Access Channel and is being recorded for the broadcast of future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded, both visually and audibly. Appointment 7:30 is Kathy Sinata regarding her request for use of Heron Park for public rosary. Anybody here?
Yeah, that's me. Yep.
Yeah.
No.
What? Oh, okay.
Yep.
What? I don't know. So, this is, you want me to come up like this?
Whatever you're comfortable.
Okay. So, this is the third time we've talked. So, the last time when we had this meeting, we talked about me just bringing forth, you know, six dates or so, and because you didn't want to do it a blanket every Saturday. So I did another request to start May 6th. I don't have the dates in front of me for the next six Saturdays. And what we do is just we do a prayer of the rosary for traditional marriage, and we go on the other side of the Herring Run where the pecan, what is it on? On the other side of the rosary, like inside that Kwan parking spot.
The veterans area?
Yeah. So we did it for almost maybe 9 months last year before somebody put in a complaint, I guess, on why, I don't know. And so then we came back to you guys to request to hold it on Saturday. So we've been doing it right now in the church, but it is a public rosary, so that's why we'd like to have it out in the public. So it takes us maybe 45 minutes tops. We're there at 12 o'clock, we like to start it, and we're done by 12:30. So 30 minutes in there. And there's probably just a small group of us, maybe 10 right now tops.
Sorry, 12 to 12:30?
Yeah, 12 to 12:30.
12:45?
Yep. 12 to 12:35 is probably. You know, we get there a little bit before 12 because we like to start right at 12.
Yeah, one of the things we had a problem with was assigning dates way ahead of time,
right?
Because it's an open space to public.
Exactly.
And having free access to all people and all groups. I mean, it is actually used for weddings and stuff too, and all those things. So.
Right.
We had talked about alternative spaces. Did anything come up in that department?
No. Well, I mean, when I first originally had started this, I did check into other spaces, and this was one that was presented to me. It wasn't really one that I had asked for or, you know, looked into. But it just seemed like, I want to do it in Pembroke, obviously, because I'm from Pembroke. And the other one, they do stuff on Saturdays there. So this just seemed like a very easy access place for everybody. So we did it for almost 9 months without any... pond. So the way that it ended last time was, you know, just for me to put in like, you know, 4 or 5 dates and do it at a time. And if nothing was going on at that time, then, you know, you guys would just kind of like, you know, say it was okay for that amount of times. And then I would have to come back in again and just keep doing it like that. If something else is there that you think we can't be there, then, you know, we wouldn't do that date or whatever. So I think of my one from last time. I don't have a copy of it, unfortunately.
No, still nobody's looked into any other locations?
No.
Or any, like, sharing, you know, one time here, another time there, moving it around or anything?
No, because, I mean, one of the things, too, I've already, because there wasn't any problem with it before when I asked, I've already made up cards and they're already out there, like, as far as, you know, our location and where we live, so. So that was one of the things, and I just,
Okay. I don't see anything has changed since the last meeting we had. I think what our comments at that time were quite plain that, as recorded in the minutes, perhaps entertain one.
Yeah, at a time, I think.
Yeah.
That spurred everybody.
And with a bunch of other conditions, it doesn't appear that anyone's looked in any of these.
Any alternative, that's why I asked about alternative sites or what did you look into?
Well, I mean, that was the time before. The last time it was just like how it ended was that we were to just submit, you know, a couple of dates and we'd go that from there. That was how I...
I don't think we have any groups that have regular meetings there. It's just one-time things.
There's yoga that meets there. That's not true.
In the minutes,
there's the Christmas trees that are there for months at a time. So
that's a nonprofit group that actually puts energy back into the land there and is helping us restore that property. So kind of all in.
I'm only asking to do the illusory.
They're not a good comparison to the tree peeping and stuff.
Well, his thing was that nobody does it ongoing like that, and I was just coming back with there are things that ongoing. And I didn't realize this was still for debate. Like I said, the last time we talked about it was like, give us 4 or 5 dates at a time, and then we'll...
Well, I think we also
that,
said...
That isn't what the minutes...
Alternative locations and other things were brought up as well.
This is the third meeting that I've come to for this.
I've been here both.
So the second meeting was... the first one was, to see if we could find another location. The second one was, you know, we can't give you a blanket for the whole year, which is what I was requesting. Can you give us 4 or 5 dates?
I think you heard 4 or 5.
Rick, if I could quote just from the minutes, it says, she was advised to submit a request in April for a one-time use permit for a Saturday in May.
Mm-hmm.
And the minutes are there. And then it says, it goes on additionally, that she was told the police chief and these people would have to get permits for signs and so forth. And we don't see that any of that was done. I mean, she's looking for, you submitted for the whole month of May. I mean, that's not one specific day. And that's just what the minutes said from the last meeting.
It is.
Recorded minutes.
We can't give really carte blanche to any one person for any period of time. We can certainly go through the process and go through one date at a time. And again, that's why I suggested we look for a place that was more hospitable towards everybody being happy. I do know that there have been signs left on the street and on the site there that were just one-sided signs, you might say. And they were left in the street one time. I actually cleaned them up.
Not of our signs.
Well, it said one marriage, one, you know, man and woman. So I assumed it was yours. It was right after meeting. That was actually, I picked it up. I actually had a detail there when I was looking for the parsnip. So it was recorded.
I don't know how. I only had 4 and I still have 4.
It was a little stick up while we saw it. It was right in the road. So I didn't make it up. It was recorded by a police myself at the time.
It's a letter from Mr. Thorne saying that they have a date that's approved.
That's 2016.
I mean, I mean, we were approved.
For one day.
And then we were approved after. I have two letters. We were there for 9 months. I don't know
if that is even relevant right now. You've asked for 4 days, and I can't give you 4 days. I'd like to just table this. If you want to come back with
more information,
more in line with what we have spoken about, then that's fine.
So feeling a little biased in here too. So do you want me to come back every time with 1 date? Every time I want to do the rosary?
Every time you want to do it, you come by. You have to come by with a date. Yes.
All right. So I am requesting for the 1st of May, whatever the first Saturday is. I'll come in every week if that's what it takes.
Wow, got a big one today.
We have to come back. We didn't advertise it as it. No.
So do I need to write a new one for May 6th?
Well, whatever date you have to request.
If not,
we move the table.
Move the table.
I'll second you.
For when she returns.
We have two things.
Just for discussion. I mean, even if she came in with one Saturday a month, that would be an option.
We didn't say we'd give her one.
I would be reasonable to one Saturday a month, there's so many.
Clean up their signs.
Well, there's so many. I didn't see the sign. I think so many people.
It was recorded by the police.
That this time of year,
what I'm looking at, the more I think about it, I'm looking at, she's more of a demonstration.
Yes, I
said. In other words, if she wants to do the rotary on the rosary on the back side of it, on the north and east sides of the river, in the park, I might be more susceptible. But she wants the roadway so she can
do signage.
Disturb the traffic on the road and everything else. And that's not what the park is there for.
I didn't see this happen.
A tradition.
What she said last time.
One tradition, right? That's the word. So traditionally.
But even with, no matter what it is, I don't care what it is, that park should not be used for that kind of purpose by anybody.
I apologize.
Hearings now 7:40. Opening at 7:40. I am opening a hearing for the notice of intent to Copperwood Road, lot 149, lot 147, 148, 149. Excuse me. 147, 148, 179, 180, 181, 182, 183, 184.
From the people here, I think I'd like to open all nine notices, because much of what's being said is similar on all of them, and that way we can work the area that's similar and then get into the particulars of the ones that are different. And I think we can save ourselves a whole lot of time than going one.
Yep. Sure. That's why I read them all off.
Good. So I'm all for that. Hi, folks. My name is Tom Pazurski from Merrill Engineers. I have Owen Kelly here.
developer.
We have all the plans here, but rather than get all these things all mixed up,
yeah.
if we work off of his, unless we get to an area that we really need.
I think this is probably easier to do. I just want to say one thing. We were not aware that they were going to have a peer review consultant take a look at these. Mm-hmm. So we did get a letter and an email late today.
Yep.
So we printed that out. This and these are two updated sets, which I will leave to you, which address Paul's comments. So we will hustle right. quite a bit.
And you will know.
And I'll get Paul.
You know that these have this on them, right? What?
Yes.
Plan? Yeah. Okay.
These are identical. So let me give you an overview. All of this, there's no wetlands fillings on any of them. DEP has issued file numbers for all nine. There's no comments. The location of the homes and the limit of work are similar to what we presented to the overall subdivision last year. The silt sock location is the silt sock for the overall subdivision because that delineates the limit of work. They're all single family homes with on-site sanitary disposal systems, some three, some four bedroom, with associated grading, municipal water. We did add some roof drains to these plans. We also added locations and elevations for the foundation drains. Now, all of these foundations, as you know, because of the groundwater, will be elevated out there. And foundation drains will daylight and they will gravity out from the foundation itself. This particular lot here, you can see we've got the erosion control measures out here. It's all in your jurisdiction, so I mean, I don't. Yeah. You want to see the buffer zone? There it is, it's all in there. And that's the case pretty much for every one of them. Driveway coming in, similar to the plan. Septic system is kept as far away from the wetlands as we can. And we did show on every one of these, we took care when we showed these to try to bring out things that were on the comprehensive permit plan. So when they develop these individual lots, they can tend to those and say, okay, I got to pay attention here. I've got a drain here.
If any of these people want to see this, bring your chairs up so they can. We're very informal here tonight.
Okay.
Sorry.
So,
that's okay.
So they got the replication area, for example, on this lot here, and then we've got some buffer zone mitigation in here. So we brought that out so they know they need to pay attention to that when this is taken care of in here.
They're all locked the same.
They're all the same. Similar situation. I can go through all nine of these if you like. I'll be happy to, or we can talk. I think it'd probably be more productive if we cut to the chase, if you will. Then we have other hearings going on. Paul mentioned in his letter dated today that they had standing water out there 109.7. I'm not surprised. In fact, we knew back when we started this thing we had standing water, and we had it right around that same elevation. So we know we have that, and that basically is predominantly down near the lots at the end of the Copperwood Road, where it gets lower in that particular area, the back of the lots. The site's under construction for the roadway and infrastructure, so you start taking out that area, it's so flat, you take out loam, you take out subsoil, you're going to have localized puddling. The other thing that we're also aware of is we did a detailed analysis part of the subdivision of what happens with this watershed out here. And we know in a 100-year storm it floods around 111, 111.2, somewhere around there. So all these homes on this side of Copperwood Road, the outlets are at 111.5. It's lower over here. There's not the restrictions that you have. It can go downhill, head towards Pelham Street and head south from there. You did note that the that elevation of 109.7 in many locations is higher than the models, and don't get confused with spring melt, seasonal high water from spring with models. Models is where the groundwater sits for an extended period of time and it depletes the soil. So we're in fully agreement with that. We did add the setbacks from all the soil absorption systems to the wetland areas. We did add foundation drains with the outlet and the outlet invert on all of these. We've added some roof drains as well. And there were some roof drains that were down in the lower areas. And Paul pointed out a concern that they might be close to the groundwater. Would they function properly? So we pulled them uphill to help alleviate that particular concern. It's going to give a little challenge for the developer taking those back of those houses and taking the roof leaders and getting them in where the fill is, but it'll allow for the recharge of it.
Could you explain how the roof drain works?
Yeah, it's a gutter, it's a downspout, and then it comes down. What we like to do is we'll put an overflow pipe and a splash pad, but down below it's a TY. It'll go down underneath, and then we are proposing, in this case, 18-inch HDP perforated pipe. It's about 3.5 feet deep. You do want those things to get below the frost layer, so that's why we make them 3.5 feet deep. And then you put stone around it. It takes the clean roof runoff, and it recharges it.
Did I hear you say that it's wide at the downspout? In other words, there's a vent, so if the drywall fills, it'll
If the drywall fails, yeah. We put a protective measure in. As you come down on the surface, just like a regular gutter downspout that has just an elbow in it, this is a Y. Goes down, if this backs up, it can come up and go out the overflow.
That is a splash pad, like a moment.
Yeah. I think probably the most important thing that I've talked about many times, I know Paul has, and I know Owen has been working with it, is the key is when they're filling these lots here, the most important thing that they need to do is clean out all the loam, all the subsoil, get down to the natural soil down there. And the material that they're bringing in has to be the similar quality. So in this case, a gravelly sandy material, maybe 10% fines on it. They have a pretty good source they're taking from now that's been tested periodically for a sieve analysis. So we keep the natural permeability of the soil when they fill these lots. And
will you be periodically checking the soils?
Yeah, Paul and I have been. We've been out to the pit.
Yep.
Yeah.
What is periodically? Just.
Paul, you're out there about every week, aren't you, just about?
Usually a couple times a week, and more frequently the last couple of weeks, because we're paving the binder course, the first binder course tomorrow. So it's been busy the last 3 weeks out there.
And I have to say that I found Paul there this afternoon on the phone with Tom.
Yeah, so we talk very regularly.
He was on the phone with me this morning.
So we're keeping a very regular eye on everything. Now, there is a comment in here, and I think it's a good comment. I had asked Paul what he meant by it. Landscaping plans and details should be provided to ensure appropriate plantings are utilized within the buffer zone and compatible with the ordinance. So what we did on that is we've added, and I have here, pass these around if you'd like, example, I'll give Paul to draft copies of these order of conditions and the special conditions, so you folks can have it crafted the way that you see necessary. But what that is we put in there a note on the plan, and if you look at special condition 22, that special condition says that when they are developing these particular lots here, that they need to tend to and make sure that they comply with the overall subdivision order of conditions. And that whatever they do basically complements that. And we're saying that, recommending that before the building permit sign, that they have to then put in a landscape plan to show that it's not interfering with anything that was approved for the overall subdivision, and it's just normal landscaping that takes place. But we can't condition it prior to issuing an order of conditions. They need a buyer for the house and the boss, and any of you guys don't think otherwise, boom. The woman of the household has to approve the landscaping, I'm sure.
The number 22, you're saying before we issue a building permit, is that a little soon even? Is it before landscaping begins, it must be approved?
That's probably even better.
Yeah. How would the board like to do that?
Just
run the, in other words, before landscaping begins, run the plan by the board.
Okay.
For its approval.
Sure. Would you want to make like a, would you like
to submit? I think that's better than doing it at the building permit, because the building permit still, we only have.
Yeah, I mean, things might have to change when they're grading things off as well.
I agree. I agree with that. You're better off to wait till you see what you really come up with at the final. Now, this type of landscaping has nothing to do with the other landscaping director.
Nothing. That stuff is just lots and stone. Just the lots itself.
Yep.
Correct. And then there's general notes on the lots. Lot one is wet.
Before we get there, there's one here that we jumped over, and I don't think we really intend, but it's the grading. In other words, you're not going to sell a house that the neighbor isn't graded yet. Is that correct?
Yes.
That says the neighbor isn't graded yet?
Well, yeah. I'm a neighbor.
Number five.
They were worried that we might need a construction easement to go between the two, one lot where they overlap.
So we have an easement built into our PNS. We have an easement of 15 feet on either side of the property line built in for every homeowner.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, so that's built into our agreement with anybody who buys. So that way we can finish the grading and they can't say.
That was a complete plan we presented, and it's still the plan when we did the subdivision, is to also get these lots rough graded off.
Right.
So everything is seamless from lot to lot. Yeah.
Right. I mean, we've actually started loading around some of these first couple lots just to get everything stabilized. And for that same reason of, so we don't have humps. We'll fill them first and then do the excavation.
So,
So are there any questions on the general comments Paul had? Any other ones?
I'm just trying to brainstorm on the landscaping plan. I need to come to the board for the certificate of compliance, just to sign off the order of conditions. Should we make that a condition to receive that?
What we normally do when you go with our certificate of compliance is we like to see the landscape in.
Yep.
And the grass mowed twice.
So right for the full.
Yeah.
So to receive a partial, which is what I need to close on a house.
Right.
Do we want to set it so that way you would approve that the landscaping, so the plantings, are in line at that partial, or in line with?
We will approve that way as long as your buyer and financial people, are accepting the fact that somebody is responsible to get it done.
Right. So we have to put the plantings in ahead of time for the partial, right?
Yeah. Yep. Yes, we will issue partials for you anyway as long as your financial people are happy with it.
Yep.
And the work is done.
Right.
Then, just for our own internal sake, does anyone have any problem with the rough?
No. Nope.
All of you?
I'm on board with everything. I think we're, as Mr. Pazurski has indicated, last year in April 29th, I think, when the current order for the development was issued, it made sense at that point in time to defer the action on each of the individual lots.
Correct.
Make a long story short, until tonight and after tonight. Okay. So this is the first opportunity that I think the town, the commission, and the applicant has had to kind of get to the next stage of construction of the site. We started back in August. We're paving the first course of asphalt tomorrow morning. And obviously one of the zoning board conditions was no release of lots until the binder course is down in place, inspected, and approved. So things are moving along, fairly orderly. Sealing Corporation was out there the last 5 or 6 months doing the site work, and knock on wood, things were going smoothly and efficiently out there. Nice. And we just hope that they can continue. The rain we had 2 weeks ago has been kind of a major impediment into the groundwater table at this time of the year. The groundwater is subsiding a little bit, but at least now is a good time to bring everybody back to the table again together to proceed to the next step. So if they're going to be getting a foundation permit or up to 9 permits in the near future, then obviously the commission has to review everything and issue an order of conditions for each of the lots, I believe. So. I was out there the last few days just reviewing the plans. You know, some lots are really ready to go right now. A couple of the lots still have a sizable amount of water on them. There's some photos here, but you can drive out there, you know, anytime you want, kind of take a peek at everything. But, you know, the site is very sensitive. Everything's been clear and grubbed. Everything's been clear cut. So the abutters' protection, we just want to make sure it's protected there because, you know, the groundwater is up, but we just don't want to get any higher where it could impose some sort of a inconvenience on anybody's private property.
And I'd like to ask the board to conditionally approve the general comments, and then we'll go on to the individual lots, per se, having known that these are already on here. We're taking what you said is on here.
Yep, that's true. Okay. I'm moving these with you as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
I move that we accept the generals.
I'll second them.
Aye.
Okay. On to the specific comments. I think we can pretty much sum it up. Lot one. Lot 18 and 17, no surprises, 18 and 17 are the last two on the left before the crossing. Lot 1 is out in the back right. They have standing water in the back of them. Slow drainage, there's wetland areas all near there. It drains very slowly, there's upland areas. So the back of these lots, obviously a little common sense here. Let them dry out a little bit before you start working on them.
The rest of the lots, 19 also on that. That's at the top.
Yep, line. 19 as well. I'm not surprised either. That's a really flat area that drains out in the back there, and that's why we're proposing the swale in the back there and the extensive stormwater along the left side of the road too.
What do you do about that witness in the future? It's going to come back.
Well, the reason why you have a lot of localized wetness there now is because they've excavated the top and the subsoil, and they've left low spots. So when it rains, the water goes in the low spots. So when the grading is done, it's going to grade down to the natural grade and continue back to where it went before. Now remember as well, one of the key, the most important thing of this component for this whole stormwater system here is to grade the lots off as shown on the subdivision plan and on these lot plans. Because what we've done, and if you recall, it's probably about 60% or more of that watershed that used to go in to the area between Birch Street and the crossing where the logging trail is, is now directed to the south side into the larger stormwater area. So we're not putting more water there, we're putting actually less. So there's less of a discharge in there.
I remember so you talked about some wicking
correct.
And stations like
yep,
that.
Yeah, they're going to be all on the bottom of the basins.
I know.
Is it so we personally talk?
Do we want to take these lots that we know are wet right now and post them on for a couple of weeks from now and get to the ones that we
that's
can
fine.
Work with?
Honestly, I don't really think it matters. It's just that they just, you can do what you like.
Well, I mean, I want to make sure that we,
that's
that,
fine.
That,
yeah, Tom,
that
17,
the engineering
18,
people are satisfied that these lots are ready to be filled.
That's fine, yeah.
And it appears we have four or five that you agree on could could be used, and I would imagine
yep.
Mr. Kelly is ready to start working on them so that, in other words, we could, if we can fast, not, I don't want to say sorry, scratch fast track, if we can expedite
focus, yeah,
some
right.
over others to get the project moving, then I would think that might be a step in the right direction.
Yeah, that's fine. The only other thing that I would mention is if they're allowed to get these other lots going concurrently, they can rough grade, they can fill, they can get the water going where it needs to go as well.
Yeah, well, they can do that without our giving them a building permit. That's
right.
All
it's
part
still,
of the
right.
subdivision.
That's correct.
They don't need
right.
us. They don't need our approval for
yeah.
that.
No, that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah, that's fine.
For those
yeah.
lots, 1, 17,
18, 19. Yep. Okay.
Those, yeah.
Yep. Okay.
Well, one, instead of saying which ones we don't want, which ones can we, which ones do you,
2 through 6,
feel are such that they could start doing work on.
I've seen improvement, Bob, the last 4 or 5 days. I was first out there Wednesday, Thursday of last week. My notes were predicated upon Thursday of last week, back out again yesterday, getting the road prepped for paving. And, you know, with the windy, drier conditions and no real rain the last 7 or 8 days, you've seen improvement out there.
The next 5 days are different.
Yeah. Right. So obviously you look at lots 2, 3, which are around the road, the small cul-de-sac ends, Road A, or Ironwood now, or
it's
Silverwood?
That's Silverwood.
Silverwood.
Yep. Okay.
So Silverwood's the first one coming in. Those 4 or 5 lots around that cul-de-sac, and even the two that are butt up to the stormwater retention basin at the south end of the cul-de-sac, those can basically be built on, you know, within a week or so. I mean, some of you can, you know, can build on tomorrow if you really want, but by the time you write the order of conditions, a 10-day appeal period, those 4 or 5 lots should be fine. Yeah. It's the 3 lots, 17, 18, and 19, that are on the main road going in where we have the big topsoil pile and, as I call it, Lake Copperwood out there. There's still a lot of water out there.
Yeah.
But again, I just don't want that water getting super sensitive with the properties in the back, because ultimately that's supposed to drain to the south, as Tom has indicated. So that's kind of an important pond that we don't want to get any worse out there.
Right. The thing you got to be aware of too is how everything works out there. I've been studying that place for the past 6 years, and you get the spring melt. You got to be careful between the end of March right through the leaves start popping, because it's a slow, low plateau. If the ground's got to defrost, then it's going to, you'll have some uptake, but not a lot. And then it slowly finds its way south towards Pelham Street. But then once the everything starts warming in the wetlands, then it's not sucking up the water.
All right, if we were to turn our attention to lots 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, is that?
Yeah, that's great.
That's fine.
You've seen his comments on these lots.
There's nothing really major.
I'm sorry, there's nothing really major.
That's all right.
There's a gentleman who wanted to speak also. Anybody in the audience wants to speak?
Yeah, Rick Soller of University Ave.
Hi, Rick.
How you doing, Tom?
Good, how are you?
Good. Can you explain to me the relationship between the lot numbers that we received and the letter that was sent from your company and the lot numbers that are numbered?
Absolutely, be happy to. When you go to land court, land court is going to pull the land court lot numbers from around the surrounding area. They basically say, in this case, they pretty much dictated to us, you need to start at lot 145 and go from there. So that's the reason. Because there's other properties when you look at land court plans. It's not the same as perhaps maybe the assessor's lot number they may assign. But in this case, it should be, because we sent the assessor the approved land court lot numbers and street names on a plan with an engineer's letter to certify that those are the lot numbers.
And those lot numbers that were in that letter, where are those in relationship to the plan you have in front of you?
Okay, those are these are at the beginning of the site, the other end of the site away from where you live.
Okay.
And the old lot numbers used to go, I think, lots
so we can keep in
1, 2, and 3 on the left side, and then it worked its way around the subdivision itself.
Right.
So it's everything on the east side of the log and trail on the far side. They haven't even gone near your side yet.
Okay.
Yeah, before we go over there, we have to do a wetland crossing, which we'll be talking to this board about. Anyway, so it's at least 6 to 8 months before we're
okay. The area you were talking about, the actual
we're over that.
Just trying to get the relationship where we're
in. Yeah. The neighborhood. Yeah. The neighborhood houses.
Yeah, they still have to get all the lots on this. Stuff over the next 4 or 5 months. Mm-hmm. We'll be on this side. Okay. The first 19 lots are over here.
Thank you.
Yep.
Chair recognizes.
Is it possible, Tom, you may already have it, a single sheet plan showing the original 34 lots, 1 through 34, as we work our way around, and now maybe in parentheses as you did.
That might not be a bad idea to provide that.
So whether it's on the board here or the zoning board, somebody in
town. I'd like it in on a 9 by 12 that could be sitting in the file or put in the computer because...
Well, he called me on the names today and I didn't remember the names. They just changed the names a few weeks ago.
I was confused. I was just trying to find out, lot one is the first one. No, it's lot 185 or something.
Right, no, you're right, it is confusing.
I know that the assessor's office is working on numbering all the lots.
Right.
Might I suggest we wait until they're finished
now? We get
one sheet with all the house numbers.
Jeannie at the assessor's office is working on it. Once she cements it in, she has the information, the correct numbers from the land court, the correct street names from the land court. Let her get that as public record, and then you'll be good to go.
Right.
Yeah, we'll have to put it back to what we started.
House numbers, lot numbers, the original lot numbers, and the land court lot numbers.
Yeah, okay. Yep.
On one sheet. That, yep.
Anybody else?
All right, well.
Okay.
I would like to take lot, I'd like to continue, I want to continue everything.
You want to what?
We have to continue all of it too, but no, we don't. I'd like to close on lot, unless somebody has something more to say. On lot 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6.
Second.
By closing, that means we've got all the information in, now we have time to write our orders.
Correct.
Which we hope will be ready for next week, and if they are, we'll try to make sure it's ready to be signed so that you can have your time from then on.
Thank you. Thank you.
The remaining lots, lot 1, 19, 18, and 17, I'd like to continue.
Tom, you were submitting, you were preparing notice of intents for the rest of the lots.
Correct.
What do you think those might be ready?
Longer,
further out?
No. I'd say the first phase would be the next 2 weeks.
So,
we continue for 2 weeks. Some of these have got piles of loam on them and all, too.
Yeah, yeah.
If we give it 2 weeks, if you're ready, we'll look at them. If not, we can...
Why don't we say 3?
All right.
Because he might have another group in, and that way we can do all of those at one time. If that works for you guys.
Yep.
Save your time and meeting schedules.
Works for me.
Okay. 3 weeks.
Okay.
We need a second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Should I leave this set up in case somebody else needs it?
It was over on the phone.
Sure, that would be good. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much, folks.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you, Paul.
We just
We continue.
Okay.
Satisfied with all and have a place to go. And we're ready for the other
35. Ridge Avenue. It is
a little late.
No, we're early, actually.
Yep.
Yeah,
so you're 25.
Yeah.
And we can't
start.
Can't get in there, so we've got other business that we need to take care of.
Yes.
Old business or new business with the parsnip, anybody?
What's new business?
Under our discussions and we need to vote in the town meeting warrant. There was an article that the town is paying us back $5,000, which is part of the court money that we used to buy a piece of property for the town a number of years ago. Being as the town is strapped for cash right now, in a meeting, I suggested perhaps we could postpone that for another year. And the selectmen were very enthusiastic about it. So I'd like the board's approval to back up what we already said, that we'd wait another a year for that payment. This money would go into our open space account for further purchases.
So if we vote against that, will they take it off the warrant, or will it still go up for a vote for the people?
What?
Will the people still vote on it?
No, in other words, no action. That's what they'll. It's already in the warrant, so it's no. It has to be taken care of that way. And they'll put it back in. And they've been very good at that. It was a, I believe we had $45,000 started, and they've been, whittling away a little at a time.
I think it was 55 and they've been giving us 10 years every year. They were giving us 10 for a while. We accept a delay in the payment for a year.
This is next year.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the whole business, I don't think we have. Nothing on the bicentennial trail.
The only thing I have to say is my time is getting short as far as having time to go do anything and contact anybody. Some 14 projects started up again today, so if anybody else has time to try to contact these people, that would be great, but I just don't have the time right now.
It's going to be a whiz bag for you.
Yes, it is.
I can go to Parsnip. We have a letter from Landscapes that John Gettner, he would treat our parsnip at no charge if allowed to do it with certain processes, which he outlines here. We'll have this letter given to everybody. And I myself, even in the worst of times, I'm a green person, but in the balance between losing that watershed, that beautiful, best pristine coastal freshwater tidal watershed. I think it's, you listen to him, he's a professional, he's a caring person, he does a lot of organic. And I would, if possible, move that we could allow him somehow. I don't know if that would be to allow this or what the process is. So, but I myself would trust this person to do whatever job he chose to do, as long as it was lawful.
All right, I think because of the nature of where we are, we need to run this by Mr. Thorne and Appstown, just because we're in an area that
is very sensitive, I agree.
Do you guys know what this glyphosate is?
Well, this, what I wanted to do is table this for further consideration until we have more information on this paper, and we'll get this to you and we'll do our homework by next week. Because it's really paramount, though, that the dates he looked at in this and the time frame of what we're going to do. He's very good at what he does.
We ran into it when we were talking to somebody else, and it may not even apply to this piece as where it did out on Route 14.
Yeah.
They had to make sure they had a right-of-way permit.
He has all these things, number one. He has all the permits.
So we may not be in the right-of-way here.
Well, that's what I don't know, but I know the last time we had looked at, the gentleman who looked into it had said we need to make sure
but it's up there.
We had to make sure we had the person who was doing it had a right-of-way permit to work in the right-of-way.
This guy is right above board. There's no problem with that.
Will you take the responsibility of making sure that the fish fry people have electricity?
That's easy. You just turn it on, right?
Right. In other words, you're just going to open it up, make sure it's all out for them.
Just so everyone else would be worth thinking of manning that station throughout the fish fry, and at different periods we have been manning it, trying to keep people with nets out, people period out. And,
we've already had a request for the thing, so
you
people have the keys and all.
Yeah, I'm going to be there turning the nets out and the barricades anyway, so piece of paper.
Denise Stones, right?
Beth
Dwyer. Okay, Beth Dwyer.
90% of the time they were on anyways. They're very rarely shut off.
What time?
They never locked.
2 minutes.
Good morning. Anyone reading the minutes of the 27th? They were sent to you.
I know.
Sent to me here. But I never read them then. Are they in this package?
One question I had to put to you, because again, I'm lost at this.
Yep.
Where is Bog 12 again? I was asked by the DPW commissioners.
Right behind the water department where we planted the trees.
Yep.
And they put the archway for the handicap.
So that's blocked off. Okay.
As far as I've been told, and all my maps say something.
Okay. Yeah.
You never know.
Gene has known as lower bar.
Yeah.
By
the lower bar, yeah. Or the wet bar, yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, that's that was always lower bar.
So it's the one out behind the garage.
Yeah, the lower one okay. With water on it.
Okay.
Well, the last place that the water goes.
With the 100-foot people.
Now, 97 and a half feet, but who's counting this?
Well, I just, Gene asked me, and I saw last break when I see him, because Gene got the letter from you.
We are having the other day. A lot of trouble getting North Atlantic cedar stock. It has become the most hard stock to buy. You're going to have to buy a year and a half to get any North Atlantic cedar spare wood. And they're just not bad. That we started, Bob, and everybody's doing it now.
Well, I think you want to look into it, find us some prices ahead of time, what we have to do to... Again, maybe we don't want to buy too much at a time,
in case things
change between now and then.
Yeah, but that bog's a wet bog. It's a good candidate. The deer don't mess it up much, which is good. The black racers keep the voles down out there. There's a couple of pairs of beautiful black racers out there. The scare joggers to death. Make them run fast. But it's a good location. I found that it's suitable, very suitable. And as far as many trees, considering they're getting harder and harder to get, we want to rethink that and maybe pot up the ones we get and keep our own stock too ahead. So it's a long-term process.
Any problems?
Nope.
I'm good.
Okay.
You good at it?
Table.
I wasn't there, sir.
Table the parsnip for further consideration until next week.
Yeah.
And the cedars will move on with out of pace.
I move we accept the minutes of March 27th.
Second.
Everyone in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Well, it must be about at the time for the next one, right? 8:29 for the next one, yep.
That's flipped over. Yep.
This one.
Nope. That. Yeah.
That
right there. That's the back. That's the front.
This one we just approved.
Yep. This one, real quick.
Well, this is here for our information.
Yeah, that was for the Kathy Sincotta appointment. Okay.
They did it and made a pile of everything that's there in case something came up. Who said what?
Yeah,
when.
That's good.
Well, the top page was the summary of all of the documentation that was underneath. Right. So if you wanted to see specifically what had happened, you could look at that with the minutes.
Coast Engineering, Duxbury, engineer for the Mullins property at 35 Ridge Ave. I was before the commission 5 years ago. We were before the commission in June of 2012 to petition the commission to tear down the existing house and build a new house on the property. The order of conditions was issued, 56-918, no work was done. 4.5 years later, we come back, and the Mullins now have definite plans to basically do the same thing in 2017 that was on the docket for 2012. The plan has changed a very small amount. The square footage of the house is within 5-10% of what it has been in the past. The Mullins bought the property in 1987. They've owned it for 30 years. It's an old summer cottage bungalow type house. And obviously, based on the existing homes in the neighborhood, some homes have been updated, others haven't been. And the Mullins has, you know, have made the decision to go to that extreme. They've hired an architect, and the plans are being finished up. It's just a matter of going through the permitting with the Conservation Commission here in Pembroke. And because it's a pre-existing non-conforming house on a non-conforming lot, we also have to go to the Zoning Board of Appeals in Pembroke on 2 weeks from last night on May 1st for the special permit hearing. We did the same thing 5 years ago, and again, both permits were received, but no work was done. Everything expired, so we're back to square one here. The property itself is about 18,000 square feet, 18,790. There's about a 36 to a 38 foot vertical drop from the driveway coming in from Ringe Avenue down to the pond. The pond is obviously very sensitive to groundwater and drinking water for, I think it's Abington Rockland, so it's there, and everybody respects that position that is there at this point in time. The elevation that we show on the plans was actually the elevation from 5 years ago when we did the last work out there the last month or so before the rains 2 weeks ago. The water was actually significantly lower and further away from the house then versus what it is now or even what it was 5 years ago. So we took the worst case scenario and put that on the plan itself.
Because below, the below or the high?
The high point.
The high point.
So it was like 25, 26 feet from the house then. It was probably more than 45 to 50 feet a month ago. Okay, obviously it's a lot closer now, but when we filed everything 2 weeks ago, it was before the range we had on the, you know,
how much difference did it rise up, roughly?
I don't know, 4 or 5 feet.
Yeah, I've come up a bunch. I don't think it's as high now as what it was again 5 years ago, but we usually go with the worst case in the year with anywhere from out.
That's big sandy, that's probably never
going to
come up fully again.
Correct. So the plan that you see, the original house, or the townhouse, is about 2.7 feet off from the southwest property line. The new house is actually going to be, you know, fairly rectangular in shape. There's very few inside and outside corners to make the construction as efficient as possible. We have two cutouts on the right-hand side here. One is for the stairway to go from the first floor to the second floor, and the other one, I think, is for a fireplace on the other side as well. Okay. So the main living space will be within the rectangle itself. The main house is about 24 feet in width by about 40 feet in length, plus a pre-season porch out on the pond front. Because of the lay of the land, all the construction, fortunately, for the Conservation Commission's review is from the upland side, from the higher elevations themselves. We have a couple of retaining walls that we're going to maintain, so a lot of the demolition work and removal work will be done with the excavators reaching over the retaining walls, picking up everything, and then rotating the equipment and loading up everything on the upland portion itself. 5 years ago, at the direction of the commission, we put in the silt sack around three sides of the property. We're proposing to do that again this time, so really 270 degrees of the property will be covered by the silt sack material itself, and that will still provide us with enough space to do the work from the top and give us a little space at the bottom to provide for the cleanup work after demolition and obviously the construction of the new house, the biotech foundation for the porch itself.
New foundation included?
Yes.
What are those squares, rectangles down below the house?
Those are stone walls that are there. Let me give you a couple of pictures. A couple old stone walls that have been there for many years, and those will probably be disturbed during construction, but probably put back together again at the end of construction. This is pictures of the house looking down from the hill. Right. You can see the stone walls on the down by the water's edge itself, and that's usually what we use.
So you use the word probable. That's not an acceptable word. They're going to be disturbed and replaced, or they're not going to be disturbed and replaced.
I would say a good contractor should disturb those stones, at least those closest to the three-season porch, because they're too close right now to tear down and rebuild. And part of the landscaping plan will be basically to return it to its original condition at the end.
Your sock goes on which side of this diagram?
It's going to go just on the inside of the lot line itself, a couple of feet.
Would it be above this?
Yeah, it's going to go down here probably.
Below the wall.
Well, put this way, everything within the limit of construction will be inside the wall. I would say right now, I mean, not knowing who the final contractor would be, I just want to be a little bit conservative and include more of the space with the silt sock if we have to. We can go either way right now because the silt sock in here will keep at least any debris from the foundation disturbance at bay here.
Right.
If we go on the water side of the wall, it may be a little bit too much space in that area, and we could end up with a little bit of erosion between the demolition phase and the new foundation.
What if along the pond, actually, you put a double one then? You do a double, do one here, and then, you know, not the whole thing, but just in this area.
Sure.
You go with a double silt sock.
You can just condition that in, if it's an extra 50, 75
yes,
feet.
Yes, go with that.
The vision for the sake of 10 feet.
Yeah. It's right on, though. Basically, you know, rather than wish we did.
It's better to have too much and not need it than
correct.
Exactly.
And we're going to have extra out on the site. We'll have extra out on the site anyway, so should there be a breakage or some sort of a deluge of rain or whatnot, then at least we'll have, you know, material out there that the contractor can use immediately to kind of improve something or repair something.
Quite a hill.
Yeah, it's quite a downhill.
It's a good slope.
Saying that, say it goes forward, I would recommend a very tight time schedule on, you know, compacting the work to get it closed back and get a foundation in there. You know, don't take, you know, do a short period of time, not rushing anything, but don't extend the period of time that everything's open to a, say, a potential flood.
I think even 5 years ago, we had a couple conditions within the order that during the demolition phase, anything that was still left exposed would be covered at night until the workers came back the next morning to continue with the demolition work.
I'm more worried about a big water blow. I think the top stuff, the material's easy to deal with, but say there's a real rain and it's just a funnel.
Exactly. And Doug Bailey's our surveyor, so he's going to get in there right after the demolition phase and pin everything for the foundation.
I believe in construction too on this driveway coming in, that with extra siltation there, if we're looking for heavy rain, they can stop some of the downhill water and divert it before it gets into the construction zone area.
Into a vegetated area rather than just into a...
And that material is easy to set up, stake every 8 to 10 feet, and really, it's small money compared to the total construction cost.
I have faith that the people in this area have dealt with this problem, and they're going to be on top of it from day one.
Other than that, that's basically the gist of it as it relates to the construction within the buffer zone, and at least what we didn't do 5 years ago, we will do later on this year. Hopefully, all goes well.
So, anybody like to speak? Anybody? Or?
Yes, Joseph Shaheen, 2900 Shab, which would be next door. Is this silt going to be this long, is it?
That's the silt sack, Joe,
sock.
That's going to be used to hold the soil into the lot so it doesn't erode downhill either towards the pond or across the lot line.
The same as hay bales.
Yeah,
the same thing.
That's a modern version of hay bales.
Keeps everything on the Mullins lot.
So that's on the Mullins lot.
Correct.
Then there have to be 15 feet from the line of the...
No, it's not a structure, it's just temporary siltation material during construction. We can move in a foot or two if you want from the right of way line.
No, this I want this wall, this fence to be taken up. I don't know why this has been there. This fence does not belong to anybody. This right way is my right
the
way.
The fence is our fence.
I'd be more than happy to talk to you offline about it, Joe, but it's not part of the commission's responsibility here as far as entertaining things with the wetlands protection.
I don't know what they have right or not, but I want to bring up their attention or to whoever temptation, because that's not been done for a long time. So we have to be taken care of. As long as we are in the right way or we have... We're doing the right things. when you're taking the house out, it has to be 15 feet from the line, which you'd be in here. If that would be 15 feet...
Everything has to be done within the Mullins lot line. We can't encroach on anybody's lot line, whether it's the right-of-way on one side or the other property.
Are you talking about offsets and right-of-ways as far as buildings, or are you talking about...
No, we have to be set back. I think by law, I have to be 15 feet from the line.
So your general setbacks, you're saying?
That general setback with 15 feet. So that's 15 feet from here.
It's nothing to do with us.
Oh, no. That's nothing to do with the conservation.
Right, that would have to do with the building department.
Zoning, yeah.
The zoning.
Building zoning,
that,
yeah.
That, take that up as zoning?
No.
All right.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Any other questions?
Nope.
Thank you very much for your time.
We should close.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I move and build according to plan with conditions that will somewhat mirror the old conditions written 5 years ago and add a couple of little things that we've talked about.
5 years ago, were you guys using 12-inch silt sock?
This plan calls, that's what I say, this calls for silt sock now. We'll be
you using hay bales 5 years ago.
Yeah, we'll be using silt sock now.
I get the older wood here if you want.
Well, no, I know. Wood chips on the other side. I know 2 years ago we upped the size of the silt sock from 10 to 12.
That's, yeah, that's right.
And if you find it that it does have a natural dip to an area,
yeah,
if you want to stake it closer than 8 feet, you know, just in that area.
So I can,
you can put all the extra you want in.
Yeah.
What we require is the minimum. I mean, if you want to double row it or whatever at the bottom there, that's, you know you're here.
We vote?
Yep.
Make a move to close.
Well, yeah,
we close. We already closed.
Yeah.
We're done.
Well
done.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Listen,
thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
Wild Parson, oh, down at Keystone Street Ball Fields, Jimmy at Herringland Park. Real quick on the Jimmy at Herringland Park, I think we need to just put out a general ad as a commission that we're looking for somebody to, the herring people, put out an ad and just get a, mess around the bush, just put the ad out there.
Sure.
I talked to some, and they definitely prefer an in-ground chimney, cement block.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good night.
It's going to be an ad going up, is what I'm saying, for that one. And that's done.
That's for the construction of the chimney.
Of the chimney, yes. A cement block chimney with a footing. Bicentennial Trail.
1 second, that has to include the Historic Commission. What's that, Natural Resources Commission? Because they're going to dig on a spot that might have
Insects
in it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So you'll have to go through that.
I think the applicant that wants to do the job, that's really up to them to go through all those processes. Right, to bring them to us. But I think it's up to them. Not us to go to them, they come to us, correct? They have the permit, they come to us.
I would think, just so you guys are ahead of the game, you get your paperwork in, they were there when you find somebody, all your paperwork's in place.
And on the other hand, it takes a licensed person to put that paperwork in, so I'm going to say we put it out to bid.
Well, then we're taking a license.
You have to have a license to build anything in this town.
Well, yeah, but I'm talking about your paperwork.
It wouldn't be our paperwork, it would be the paperwork of the contractor. His paperwork.
Very seldom is the contract the person
who does.
Is okay, going so to get the...
That's what I'm saying. So we'd be the applicant, that's their officials. Okay, so we put that in before this board then.
Yeah.
And then we'd be advertising at the same time for a person.
Yeah, you can do that. Yeah. No,
thank you.
Trying to get it done, that's all. Okay, we understand that one. Bicentennial Trail, I did walk it. We need to open it up. If you want to make any dent in it, you can definitely the mowing machine. It's all small stuff on the way in. There's nothing big until you get to the oak, which is...
Well, that's what I say. I think that, I think our leaners are a bit of a problem. I don't necessarily want to have too many people walking until we take care of our...
I'm saying all at once.
Our widowmakers.
The one widowmaker I see is the big one that he's talking about. That's not a widowmaker. That's a garage flattener. And whoever else is in the garage, that's a heavy tree.
There's a couple of those at
the
heart.
The next one down the road is not that big.
The urn one, though, I think we can drop.
Yeah, I haven't been, honestly, I haven't been down there.
Yeah, I think the one at Heron Run is just a good tree man to drop. We have room enough to do it. This bicentennial, if we drop it, we get the garage.
Yeah, it's a tight squeeze, definitely. I mean, even if you wanted to be risky, it's still a real risk. I wouldn't hinge cut that thing and pull it. But to get equipment in and out without getting, the other thing is without getting totally trashed by the ticks, it's a two-handed sword. Do you bring something in and just mow the first parts, you can get in and out of there without getting eaten alive by ticks? That place is tick bomb.
Well, yeah. We have to make sure what we own.
Own it, so.
Yeah. That's the thing. We've got to look at the town, town plans and make sure we're there. Either that or we need to talk to the abutter and get the okay.
When the last conservation was in, they had trucks in there, small trucks. They were able to get in pretty far. And that's not, even couldn't do that today. We couldn't get in with any less than a bicycle.
Oh, yeah. No, it's...
We're gloves.
Most of what's in there right now, you're going to have to hand cut it.
Okay.
The mower is just going to make a mess.
Make a big mess.
Yeah, you're going to have to hand cut
it. And where would you put the brush? That's the mess.
You'd have to stack it off to the side.
Yep.
You know, left or right.
What we have said in the past when we've had other people working the trails is that as long as the brush didn't sit more than 2 feet high, is that right?
I believe so.
In other words, no brush piles more than 2 foot high.
No instant bonfires for kids.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with that.
In other words, it's cut up small enough that it would drop. In a matter of a year or two, it'll drop down. And
put a rock on top of it.
Yeah. Well, you can walk on it.
That would work, except for the ticks still love you. That place is tick heaven.
I was going to say, you could roll on it, but I was being nice.
Yeah. I could do a big belly flop on it like I do the salt hay. You see me collect the salt hay in the tubs. Flying into a big land on, I get three times as much armor. Works.
Have we signed any forms?
We have lots of forms to sign.
Let's get the forms and then we can get.
I have some new business. Okay. Who's doing the project on West Elm Street?
Right now, the DPW is waiting for CPC funds.
There's been construction out there, though.
Yes, the DPW's.
Did they cut down some elm trees?
No. Well, we cut the dead elm trees down.
They were dead?
Yep.
What about, shouldn't there be a silt sock between the construction
I went down
river?
And looked, and I counted 7 elm trees that were quite alive. Plenty of cambium on them, they're green.
I know is...
I'm just saying, I'm pretty good at this. They got cut.
And I've been doing it for 32 years, and they took the dead ones down. That's all I can tell you. The silt sock, I didn't think was a big issue, because there's enough stuff between where we're working and where the water, but tomorrow morning there will be salt sock put out there.
Good thing. It looks like you're right up against the river.
No.
How is it?
Well,
I walked it tonight.
Yeah,
I walked it tonight. There's a section that has an old wooden barrier.
Yeah.
It comes down to some cement. Then the hill is cut back. The vegetation on the side of the hill is all, it's been cut down, but it's the root is all still
right.
There.
The roots are there.
So it was down. There's one spot halfway down, but there's a 8 to 10 foot of bank area that's open. So
did you see the pictures that I sent, Rachel?
No, I didn't see you.
I was over on the Hanover side. You look, and the construction goes right down to the water. And I'm sorry, there's nothing there blocking anything.
Well, if you go out and walk it, I walked it tonight before I came here, and I saw nothing that was over alarming. But we'll take care of it anyway. The most alarming thing that I've found is that North South River claimed jurisdiction up there. In our park.
We have to do everywhere. they claim it everywhere, whether they have it.
Well, this is what I'm saying. In all the years we've taken care of the park and done everything else there, nothing has been said. Now all of a sudden, they're claiming 100 feet from the edge of the water. Well,
that's not bad. I thought they claimed
Yeah, they're trying to trump the conservation.
And they did 300.
And I don't want to fight. I don't want to fight with them, but I just want to find out why they think they have no jurisdiction on a park that we've been taking care of and had for years.
So, real quick, two park benches. The Herring Run has one park bench with rotted seat pieces that, like, if you even stood on it. The Herring Park, just different subject real quick, but the Herring Park benches that you sit on picnic tables, one of them is completely trashed up. At one whole side of the bench, I wouldn't trust it to get his legs stuck in.
In other words, are you saying the whole table needs to be destroyed?
I think before a kid gets his leg stuck in the seat, yeah, it would be better than, or pop off some.
No, I don't have time.
Yeah, or pop off some sort of, pop the boards off and screw some others on. But
so how do we get that done then?
Get some volunteers down there to do it.
See what we can arrange.
Yeah, I think it's something that just before the fish fry, it'd be good for everybody to have it fixed. Just wanted to bring that up.
So can we go back to the other subject for a second?
The other thing, I mean, I'm not, you know, I'm high school educated at that. I haven't really taken any courses, but I put some fairly good money on the fact that I can go show you five living West Elm Street trees, elms that were at least 5, 6, 7 inches across that are no longer there. And they're a hard tree to get going. We're gonna spend money for them at the ballpark. I'd just like to see them preserved when possible.
And you said that they're already growing again, so they'll be there much.
Well, I said, no, they show life. They're cambium, they're green, and they're alive. So it worked.
Whether you need a silt sock there or not, it's a good example for us to set. Where, I mean, if it's a town project, we should do everything the way we're asking other people to do them. Mm-hmm.
Well, but is the elm a protected species?
No, I'm not saying it's a protected species. I'm saying it's a tree that, left alone, would be a grand tree at a park. These were seeded trees.
Right, I'd have to see where it is.
Sometimes they go up and die. I understand that a lot of them are offshoots from stumps and old roots, and that can go on for years, but I felt these were actually seed trees. And I've seen them in Pembroke in a few places. Like to see them come back whenever possible, that's all.
I believe the whole idea of what's being done up there right now is that the town people felt that it was a disgrace coming into
I agree.
The town of Pembroke with what was there.
Yeah,
and so the DPW crew has been finding time out of their other schedules to clean it up, and now we're crucifying him in all different directions for
not crucifying.
Oh, I know, don't you? Not just there, but I mean everything else. And you know, here they are doing something beyond what is their job. They definitely have enough other things in town to do, and yet we're fighting for. Maybe we did cut down some live elms, but
I think more importantly than that one, let's go past the elms and stuff. That's what it is. The knotweed, there is no applicable way to get rid of that stuff other than dig it out, I understand. So dig it out and get rid of it all. However, you have to do it within the guidelines if it's allowed, but get it out of there. I'm all for it. I mean, dig it out, do whatever you got to do, and get rid of it. If you got to put a silt sock up to do that, put a silt sock up and dig more of it up.
Out of this whole thing, I have one major problem, because I have a major problem, is through all of this, the one thing that bothers me more than anything else is we have a damn safety factor up there that isn't been taken care of.
No, it's definitely.
And you know, we're worrying about trees, we're worrying about silt sock, and we have 5 and 6 foot straight drop over the edge with no fence, and there isn't a soul saying very much about it. And
I was going
to
get to
me,
that part.
That No, the safety part is far more important than our other and problems that we have up there.
Having lost all my best friends as a kid there off that safety drop,
it's a what do we do up there, because we don't have any money
That's
yet
what it takes.
To go into buying or doing the fence work that needs to be done to make it a decent looking park that they want there.
Safe, at least.
But
I'm all with you.
At the same time, we have something there. We don't really want to put up snow fence. That would be as ugly
and temporary. It'd be a temporary
as we
fence,
can.
You know,
and I don't know. So I'd like to have someone come up with some short-term ideas of what we're going to do, because no matter what we do for funding, there's no funding until after the 1st of July.
I would suggest that whenever we take Black Locust down, we think of this as a project where we have the best, you know, pressure-treated wood in the world that's it's an invasive we want to get rid of. Use it for posts and rails and do a park look.
And Eric, that's great and that's fun. But we can't get anything out. We have to have manpower to get these things done. And we have more projects. If we took the manpower that we have available and had them just sit down and write down all the projects, they kept busy most of the time writing down the projects that need to be done, not doing the projects.
I'm just saying, as far as money, Black Locust is free. You get it off the jobs everywhere. It would be something.
Yeah, it's free, Joe. You have to move it.
I understand. I paid to move it. But Letourneau, something like that, you may just find the right thing happens. Talk to Letourneau, see if he's got something coming out of Dexter. There's a lot of stands of it over there. And it would be beautiful stuff and last for a hell of a long time.
I think that's a great long-term
thing.
But that's not no...
I think short term, what can you really do? I think a fence would look ugly, like you said, a snow fence isn't really, you know.
Jim Stewart's coming out to look at it, to see what he can come up on options.
Well, so I think, I think sometimes we have to step back a couple of feet and look at what, there's a certain set of priorities that we need to do. We need to do all of them, but some are. One kid falls over there and breaks an arm or a leg, and all hell will break.
The second one falls, and we own you.
Right.
That's how that works. The one is kind of happens, but two, and you'd be on. And one of my dearest friends as a kid died right there under those falls. So it's definitely dangerous.
And Scott, I brought this up, but I don't mean to create the DPW as a job out there, but it was just some things that
nobody did anything for years. Yeah. So it's
I went out there, I was very surprised, and I understand it's, and maybe I'm wrong, but I understand there might be seed put in what's there, which then brings us, and we know all of this is somewhat temporary because the long range plans.
I think what I would say out of all this, right, is that we need to work together more and have a longer range plan and work together to get it done. It's a project.
Well, this,
we want to beat the project up.
I have to say, this is a project that came to a front burner only because some people with a little authority in town basically said, clean this mess up that if driving into town, it doesn't look like we're going into the,
And honestly, to get your final plan, sometimes you have to do a rough opening. Yeah. And I consider this the rough opening, and that's fine. But I think a plan of what it's finally going to be would be a nice thing to have. I'm all for your fences, and because that place is not too safe. I'd forgotten half the structures that were up on the top, all the concrete pads and everything.
That's right, the water. There's nothing stopping that stuff from going in the water.
all done talking about it, so you guys do what you want. We're trying to do something nice and get criticized for it, so you guys are on your own. Let me sign this stuff so I can get out of here.
You're taking it the wrong way, Scott.
No, I'm taking it as everything gets dumped on us. Nobody else I see out doing anything other than the stupid fish in this town. And I'm just done with it. That's all.
Well,
so I'm done.
Sometimes I think the fish are smarter than people.
Sometimes I think we worry too much about the fish and not about the people in this town. So, you know what? I'm done. You guys can take the goddamn fish. And I wouldn't care if one came back up
How does this
the rest of my life.
To be fish when we're talking about something else?
Because everybody worries about the fish, but they don't worry about anything else in this town.
So, well, you were deflecting.
Are you saying that there's a barrier there between the...
You know what, Rick? If that's what I'm doing, I'm deflecting, I guess.
I would be too.
No.
Bobby, would you say there's a barrier there between the construction and the water?
Oh, see, in other words, this is all root system.
Right.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So that you aren't going to get, you don't get...
I agree.
In other words...
You don't get a
hay bales aren't the only... and silt fence and silt sock isn't the only thing that keeps erosion from happening.
Right. Scott, I'll probably be writing my letter of resignation next week, Bob, so...
There's nothing being done to prevent erosion here at all. I mean, if anybody else did this, we'd be
in trouble. And that's simply said. Again, let's talk about solutions rather than problems. The only thing that did surprise me is I'm an elm tree guy. I like them. We want to spend money on them, and then we're cutting them down over here and spending money on them there. And I do understand, before you can see the pallet, you have to clear it to see what you're going to do with what you got. I understand that. I'm fully unaware that you can't go in there and say, okay, let's do this and this, because you couldn't see anything in there. You couldn't really, that place was so overgrown. So I think it wasn't done with intent or malice, I don't believe. It was just done, and we get overzealous and do things, and that's kind of what this board is here to do for everybody, is to kind of help everybody stay in check and do the right things the right way. As far as the fish being in competition with everything, that's nothing to do with what we're talking about. That's just deflection. I know. I just like an equal playing field for people. I think sometimes that is hard to achieve, but we still try to achieve it. But as far as the safety issue, well, you're absolutely correct. Like I said, I lost one of my best friends, 12 years old, dead, you know, right in the falls. So that is something that I don't know how to address all that. And certainly chain link is not pretty.
Move it, Wilson.